morning, Fountain City United Methodist Church. Fountain Kids is so excited this month to be learning about kindness. And kindness means that we treat people with the value that they deserve. And today especially, we are in the story of Ruth and Boaz. Ruth, Naomi, and Boaz. So girls and boys, get your devices right now. If you are streaming at home with your parents, this is the time to do that. And then we have a special guest on our video on Facebook today that will be joining at the end. So stay on there. And remember, we need to just try a little kindness and shine our light for everyone to see in the name of Jesus. Bye-bye.
City United Methodist Church, live gleamers and live streamers. We're thankful that we have live streaming this morning. We came within a hair's breadth of not being able to do that due to a sort of a system-wide outage. But we're glad that we're able to be here and that technology is on our side this morning. Thanks be to God. We welcome you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I do call your attention to some of our announcements, some of the things that we have going on in the life of the church in this coming week. And that begins today. You will notice that as you were seated, there was not only a bulletin, but there was also a card or a half sheet on top of your bulletin that was highlighting the kickoff of our faith promise commitment for the year 2021 and 2022. We hope that you will keep that in front of you, that you will be attentive to the partners that we are walking with over these next several months as we give above and beyond our general giving to our regular budget. We'll be continuing to highlight that throughout the next couple of months, but if you are ready to make that commitment now, we're not asking for funds now, simply commitments. And if you're ready to do that today, then you have a pen, you have a commitment piece, and you can complete that. And on your way out in the narthex, you will see that there is a separate basket for both depositing the commitments and the pens. We will sanitize those pens and reuse those. I also want to invite you to our Ash Wednesday service. We will be live streaming, and we'll be live gleaming here this coming Wednesday, the 17th, 6:30 p.m. We will not be doing our traditional imposition of ashes to avoid human contact, but we have a good alternative plan, and invite you to be part of our beginning of Lent this year. Along with the season of Lent, you'll notice in the bulletin that we do have some opportunities related to discipleship for adults and also children, but primarily at this point, you'll notice that adults, we have a Facebook interactive video study that begins tomorrow at noon, and that will be on Facebook. But if you cannot catch it live, it will be posted to YouTube later so that you can keep up with what Pastor Kristen and Miss Donna are doing. And then a week from this Wednesday, you'll see that there's another opportunity that will be led by a newly certified lay speaker here at Fountain City, Sandy Failing. She will be leading a study on what the Bible says about the cross. Friends, I do want to remind you that as we continue as disciples of Christ, that we have opportunities to give and support this congregation and even beyond financially. I hope that you will be attentive to those opportunities by mailing a check through our mobile app Realm, through texting, and through our FountainCityUMC.org online method of giving. We are so appreciative of the commitments that you have already made and for the gifts that you are making for 2021. We're ready to worship, I trust. And I can't tell you how good it is to see you here in person, and how good it is to greet you who are part of our worshiping community. And I know your heart's desire to be back here very soon, and we know that that day will come when we will once again be live and in this space, but we also know what opportunities await us through modern technology. Let us now enter into this time of worship.
Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship as printed in your bulletin. May the brightness of God shine around us, within us, and through us. The light of God is shining. The voice of God is calling. The love of God is with us. Our opening hymn is hymn number 173, Christ Whose Glory Fills the Skies.
Thank you.
this time, we invite any of our K through five, or through, yes, K through five, fifth grade, to go with Miss Jenny down to Wesley Hall for the Fountain Kids experience. So we'll give you all a moment to dismiss, to be dismissed. We're glad that you're here. It's so good to see you and know that the time in Wesley Hall will be valuable. Our affirmation of faith this morning will probably be unfamiliar to you, but it is an affirmation that is scripturally based, and I would ask that we now affirm our faith together. We believe in Jesus Christ, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Shine upon us with your grace, O God, that we might see what frightens us and face what threatens us. Flow through us with your mercy, that we might sense your presence, even when we have run away, and that we may know your love, even when we feel most unlovable. Abide in us with your love, for your love claims us and makes us whole. We pray in the name of the one who shines in your magnificent glory, Jesus Christ. And now may we pray together. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. Ladies, if you keep that up, we're going to have to replace the carpet because we're all tapping our toes. Thank you. And how appropriate, this little light of mine. Today's the last day in the season of Epiphany. And the season of Epiphany is all about light and about revelation. And so how appropriate this is as we transition into the season of Lent in this coming week. Our gospel lesson is from the gospel according to St. Mark, chapter 9, beginning with verse 2 and reading through verse 9. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice. "This is my Son, the Beloved. Listen to him." And suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I suppose many of us, particularly living in East Tennessee, can identify with the t-shirt message that I suppose most, if not all of us, have seen. "The mountains are calling, and I must go." That's part of a quote. It's not the entire quote, but it's part of a quote in one of the journals of naturalist John Muir of the 19th century. It has just recently become part of t-shirts and bumper stickers and, I'm sure, a good marketing campaign. Scripture itself attests to mountaintop experiences. You will remember some of those. Moses receiving the law on top of Mount Sinai. That's where Moses met God. You may also remember that Elijah, also mentioned in this text, atop Mount Carmel, taking on the prophets of the pagan god Baal or Baal. Many of the Psalms are written as journeying songs. They're captured in our book of Psalms. But these are songs that the pilgrims of the Jewish faith would have sung on their way up to Mount Zion. And now today, this rather enigmatic, if you will, passage about the Mount of Transfiguration. There's mystery that surrounds this. It's a little unclear exactly what is going on, and probably good intentioned. So, the structure of Mark's gospel, I don't think is any accident. The midpoint, just about the midpoint of Mark's gospel is this experience where Jesus is transfigured before Peter, James, and John, and they actually see not only Jesus, but they see Moses and Elijah, and they're all conversing. And as a matter of fact, this experience is further framed before and after by two accounts of blind men receiving their sight once again. One of those blind men is unnamed, is brought to Jesus, and Jesus takes some saliva and rubs on this blind man's eyes. And the blind man says, "Well, I can partially see. It's almost as if there are people, but it seems as if they're more like trees walking." And Jesus touched the man's eyes again, and his sight was completely restored this time. And then after the transfiguration, you will remember the name Bartimaeus, a blind beggar. And Bartimaeus used his ears and he heard the message that Jesus was about to pass by. And so, unlike the unnamed first man that had friends bring him to Jesus, Bartimaeus really disturbs the crowd by yelling for Jesus, "Son of David, have mercy on me." And simply because of the faith of Bartimaeus, his sight is restored. Now, this isn't misplaced. It is placed strategically in Mark's gospel because right at the apex of the Mount of Transfiguration, these disciples who have already been told what was going to happen to Jesus ultimately are still blind. They haven't gotten it yet. Jesus has said to them, "The Son of Man must suffer and die and be raised on the third day." Peter is the one that just before this account announces who Jesus is. "You're the Son of the living God. I know who you are." And then Jesus says, "Well, this is what it means, Peter. Suffer, die, be raised again." And Peter responds, "It can't be that way, Lord." And Jesus says back to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan." You remember all of that? This is strategic for Mark's gospel. And not only is Mark structured like a mountain, like a triangle, if you will, our Christian calendar is structured as its own object lesson. Please don't lose me here, because all of this matters. The last Sunday in the season of Epiphany is always Transfiguration Sunday. In the Christian calendar, that's how it works. And Transfiguration Sunday is a hinge point in how we count time in the Christian calendar. The hinge point of Lent, which begins in just 3 days, every year, 3 days after Transfiguration Sunday, is Ash Wednesday. And as you know, Ash Wednesday is the season of Lent, initiated by Ash Wednesday, is the 40 days, not counting Sundays, before Easter. And Easter, unlike Christmas, isn't the same day every year. It is related to the spring equinox. So it's here that the Christian calendar sort of merges with the lunar calendar. I'm sure many of you know all of that. But during Lent, during these 40 days, each passing day gets darker and darker. On Ash Wednesday, these pyramids of white, this stole of white, will become deep purple. That's no accident. It is to remind us of the suffering of our Lord that led to His death. It's how we mark time. It's how we merge our calendars together. Now, admittedly, Jesus' disciples, represented here by, we might say, the inner circle of three, Peter, James, and John, knew nothing about the Christian calendar. In fact, there was even no such term as Christian then. They knew nothing of the Christian calendar that would come later. We, as his followers now, can appreciate that. The marking of time where the Christian calendar, the lunar calendar, merge, we can appreciate how we mark time with the season of Lent marked on one side by Transfiguration Sunday and on the other side by the celebration of Easter. Here's the good news. During this 40 days of Lent, this long, dreary, gloomy, even time when we are challenged to deny ourselves of those things that make us comfortable, no matter which way we turn during the season of Lent, whether it is behind us or in front of us, there is the revelation of God's glory. We dare not miss that. If we look behind, we see the Transfiguration. Jesus' clothes become dazzling white. How's that for an adjective? Dazzling white. Even more than the best maximum strength Clorox. Dazzling white. And if we look in front of us, as dark as this season is, in front of us is the glory of Easter. But we know that in order to get to Easter, we have to go through the dark valley. We have to go through the purple. We have to go through the gloom. If we look behind, we hear the voice of God. This is my Son, in whom I am well pleased. Listen to Him. And if we look in front of us, we hear another divine message where the angels say to the women, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here. He has been raised just as He said he would. And so this is the good news. Both the gospel's geometric shape, like a triangle, accompanied by how we mark time, create broad strokes of an artist. An artist who invites us to step within the framework of her artistry just long enough. If we stay there just long enough, then we will experience what many have called the dark night of the soul. And even those spiritual giants that we can name will also tell you about the dark night of the soul from their own experience. If we stay true, if we stay going deeper and deeper into the spiritual life, we will find that at some point or the other, and usually several times, we will experience the dark night of the soul. And let me remind us, we won't be in bad company. Do you remember the prayer of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane? If it's possible, let this cup pass from me. Do you remember that very honest prayer of Jesus while he hung upon the cross, quoting the Psalms? My God, why have you forsaken me? We might even say, we can make an argument that even Jesus felt the dark night of the soul. And if the Son of God feels such darkness, who do we think we are that we will be immune from that and escape that? You and you. All of us gathered for worship. We may be going through such a dark time right now. Or we can recall such a time. Or we know there is such a time coming, a dark night. And I simply invite us to look through the lens of the season that we are about to enter into. And whether we look to the rear or whether we look to the fore, don't be surprised to see the glory of God. Hope for today. Peace for every day. Look through the lens and be encouraged, because the brightness is there. It really does depend upon the lens in which we look through. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
following the benediction, we'll dismiss parents of the children that we dismissed a little bit earlier. We'll dismiss parents first. And then if everyone else, if you would just hold your place until an usher will dismiss you from the back of the sanctuary, moving toward the front. May the brightness of God light our way. May the brightness of Christ shine within us. And may the brightness of God's Spirit flow through us. And may all God's people say, Amen.